We have just discussed why making an actor or stakeholder analysis may be important. Now we are going to do an actor analysis. There are six basic steps, and we will go through these steps one by one, and we will illustrate each step with an example from practice, which we call Wind at Sea, with the Netherlands national government as the problem owner and wanting to stimulate the generation of green wind energy at sea. We'll first take the first three steps, and then I'll treat the next three. So, we take the problem formulation of the client as point of departure. We then make an inventory of the actors involved, map their formal relations, and then make an inventory of their interests, objectives, and perceptions. We try to find out about their interdependencies, what are their resources and their salience, and finally, we think about and list the implications for problem formulation and for the client. We'll first take the step one, the problem formulation of the client as point of departure. In our first step, what do we have here? Well, the problem owner is the Ministry of Economic Affairs, as they are responsible for the national energy policy in the Netherlands. What's the problem or the cleft? Well, there's insufficient capacity installed at sea, and we won't make the target. What causes the problem? Well, generating wind energy is relatively expensive, and the production is intermittent, dependent on the weather conditions. So the dilemma or problem is economic affairs want to have more offshore power, but without impeding the security of Dutch energy supply and affordability. So, well, this first step was quite straightforward. We now come to the second step, making an inventory of the actors. Here, we use the basic modeling techniques taught in the Principles of Policy Analysis course. Don't worry, I'll lead you through the steps quickly. And if you really don't know, you find these basic analytical modeling techniques explained in Chapter 3 of the course book and on our open courseware pages. The basic method for making an inventory of actors is by using your preliminary causal diagram or systems diagram and by asking two questions. Which actors can actually influence important factors in my system? And the second question, who has an interest in the problem or is affected by the possible solutions? So there are two I's, influence and interest. So we start from the Ministry of Economic Affairs. What are its objectives? As we just learned, they want more offshore power generation without impeding the security of the Dutch energy supply and affordability. So here at the right, we put percentage offshore power generation and affordability, which we translate into cost of energy provision. And thirdly, security of supply. And at the left, we put their means, subsidies and granting licenses. Both means positively influence the number of new wind farms, and the licenses will also influence the size of the wind parks. Number and size, on their turn, influence the installed capacity at sea and the investment cost. The installed capacity, on its turn, influences the objectives, percentage offshore generation, and the investment cost influence the cost of energy provision. This is a nice basis, which we will detail a little bit further. The investment costs are an important factor, so let's take a look at there. At sea, the water depth is a very important cost factor. And what else at the cost side? Well, transport costs of the generated energy are important, and these are influenced by the distance between wind farms and the connection point at land. Costs are also influenced by scale. The bigger the project, the more scale advantages. And, well, what about capacity? Capacity is not only determined by the number and size of the wind farms, but also by the wind itself, and the average wind speed at location. There's one criterion left now, which is the security of energy supply. Wind doesn't always blow, so there needs to be a dynamic balance between the supply and the demand of energy. What factors determine this balance? Well, storage capacity and the number of international connections might be factors here. Well, now we can ask our two questions. We just ended with the balance on the net. Clearly, the network administrator, TenneT, is responsible here. And the EU, they determine the number of international connections, while the energy companies, the power generators and R&D agencies, do research after energy storage. The energy companies are the main investors in wind power generation, And finally, the Ministry of Infrastructure and Environment is responsible for planning at sea and thus determines the location, thus water depth and distance to shore. So we covered the influence part, and now we turn to the interest part. We ask the question, who holds an interest in the project and or who will be affected by the project? Or to be more precise, who holds an interest in any of the factors in our system? When looking at the means, it are the investors, the energy companies and the project developers who hold an interest in speeding up the permits and getting subsidies for the project. We also discover new parties. There are other users of the North Sea, fishermen and their boats and their organizations, the offshore oil industry, the shipping companies and harbour authorities, who all worry about the shipping lanes and the freedom of access. So they have a stake in the number of wind farms and their location and size. And we see a number of familiar faces too. The EU and its international connections, TenneT, the network administrator with stakes in security of delivery and transport cost, the energy companies worrying about the cost, and the Ministry of Infrastructure and Environment worrying about the percentage of wind in our energy mix. We have now seen how you can use influence and interest as tools to identify actors involved in an issue. But of course, there are other ways too, and sometimes these are easier or faster, or they may lead you to actors or groups you otherwise might have missed. Some important other methods are: look at the formal positions in a decision-making process. Who has a role in formal decision-making? We'll come back to this in step 3. Reputation is another one. You ask people, who else is important? Who are the focal organizations? This is often called snowballing. By asking around, more and more people will stick to your snowball. Another one is social participation. Who are active in this field or society? And who are the focal people, the opinion leaders? And demographic characteristics may also be a good criterion. Are all social groups represented? Do we have the elderly, the youngsters, the First Nation people, the immigrants? Well, just to give you an impression of what a good use of the presented actor identification techniques might lead to, we now show you the long list of actors we created for our wind energy case. We listed only 44 of them, but believe me, there may be more. Now that we have been able to identify everyone involved in a problem or policy issue, what shall we do? Do we need to take along everyone in our inquiries, or can we just make a smart selection to reduce our workload without impeding the quality of our analysis? Well, think back to the dispersed pollution example. I showed you there were over 80 parties involved. You cannot take along all 80. You have to come up with a trick to make it manageable. Well, there are a couple of rules of thumb. The first is that you should realize that the problem owner is an actor too, and there may be more powerful parties involved than your problem owner alone. So, how to make a shortlist? Well, you can reduce the number of actors in your analysis if only you keep the balance with the level you have chosen in your problem. And there should be a balance between the different interests and positions. For instance, you have 5 environmental NGOs, all wanting more or less the same, or 3 ministries trying to reach the same objective, although for different reasons. You may combine them, and you call them joint NGOs or joint ministries. Be pragmatic. 10 to 15, maybe 20 is enough, if only you cover the whole spectrum of concerns and issues. And then remember, any analysis is an iterative process. You learn along the way, so you can always add or remove actors from your list. There are practical methods to help you reduce your long list. The trick is called stakeholder analysis, and at this stage we use it in a very rough and unscientific way, namely mostly based on your own common sense. What we suggest you to do at this stage is to use a so-called power interest grid, a matrix with 2 axes which allows you to order your actors. And you recognize our 2 eyes here, influence and interest. The axes of the grid are power at the bottom, with the high end to the right, and interest to the left, with high interest on top. These 2 axes we use to form 4 quadrants. And now we start positioning the actors on our long list according to our estimation of their relative power and their relative interest. Do you remember the colorful map on diffuse pollution? It held 4 of these grids. So, when we have positioned our actors in the grid, consider the parties on the top right as players. They are the ones we think they are holding important means and are having interest in the subject. Those are the parties that should be taken along. The ones on the bottom left are considered crowd. They have neither interest in the subject nor means, so we can ignore them. The top left are labeled subjects. They may be interested or affected, but have low power, so we leave them out for now. If needed, we can take them on board later. And finally, at the bottom right, we have the context headers. These actors might be important. They have important means that you might need to solve the issue, but they're not very interested yet. If the letter changes, or you expect that it might change in the near future, you should definitely take them along, have them on board, and put them into your analysis. Now we know whom to take along in our analysis by making our shortlist, and we have to note down our first results. A practical way to do this is by filling out a simple table and by jotting down in the columns the values, perceptions, resources, the actors we selected for. And we select for further inquiry what they have. And we try to see the networks they are operating in. This is no longer a quick and dirty thing, though. For information on the shortlisted actors, you have to do research, desk research to start with, but maybe also by interviewing people. Nowadays, you probably start by exploring the website of the agency, the company or NGO you want to know more about. You track their mission statements to find out their values, their perceptions, and maybe their means and objectives in this specific issue. You check with whom they cooperate in all kinds of projects. You download relevant documents and reports, the annual reports, and analyze them. You learn about the players in your game. So, this is the example of starting to fill out this matrix. There's one last issue about making an inventory of actors that we need to discuss. How to go about with composed actors. Take the Ministry of Infrastructure and Environment in our Wind at Sea example. It's a big organization with many different departments. If only the cleft between the infrastructure guys, the ones who love concrete and tarmac, and the environment guys, who like trees and fresh air. In such cases, you have to check if the ministry is speaking with one voice or if different departments have their own voice. I'll be wary, this seems typical for government organizations, but the same does happen in the private sector. Think back of our Brent Spar example, where Shell Germany and Shell the Netherlands, confronted with this consumer boycott, started opposing the decision by Shell UK to dump the Brent Spar. But it might also work the other way around. The energy producers, for instance, rather than being individual companies like Vattenfall or Essent or Eneco, have much more in common, and they can be seen, maybe can be seen as one actor, Energy Net. So your rule is select the highest possible organizational level without losing relevant information or including irrelevant goals. And the other rule is don't use categories like consumers or private sector. In that case, you need a spokesperson or an organization representing such a category.